Now, when we look at this slide, I summarized this in an article I published in Lancet. I want to bring this together in a dashboard. I'm not going to go through each one of these. But what I can say is that we've got lots of treatments for bipolar mania. The newer kid on the block is Lybalvi, the olanzapine-samidorphan combination. This is the efficacy of olanzapine, which we all know well, with the mitigation of the weight. And that's obviously a valuable alternative now, bringing olanzapine back onto the option list, so Lybalvi. But I want to focus on bipolar depression. That's the enemy of the state. And in bipolar depression, two of those five agents that are approved in bipolar one, two of them cause significant weight gain. Olanzapine, fluoxetine, and quetiapine. Let's, if we can, have a look at the positives. Look at the far right-hand column, and let's just look for the word positive. Olanzapine has a positive, quetiapine, all five studies positive, lurasidone positive, cariprazine, I see three positive, lumateperone positive. So we have positive data for some of these agents in monotherapy. Most of these agents are antipsychotics. Look at lamotrigine. People often think lamotrigine is approved for bipolar depression. It is not approved for bipolar depression. It is approved as a recurrence prevention strategy, not as an acute antidepressant. Now, I use it a lot to treat acute bipolar depression. And when you look at the recurrence prevention data, it's better at delaying and preventing depression than it is at delaying and preventing mania. So it tends to operate from below the baseline, as we say, as opposed to operating from above the baseline, pushing mania down. So it is an antidepressant, but does not have that acute indication. Let's focus on those five agents that are FDA approved for bipolar depression. Details matter. So lumateperone is Caplyta. It's approved as a monotherapy and as adjunct to lithium and valproate in bipolar 1 and bipolar 2. Pop quiz, what other treatments approved in bipolar 2 depression, the most severe form of bipolar? It's quetiapine. But unfortunately, quetiapine has weight gain and diabetogenic effects that obviously limit its acceptability. Olanzapine fluoxetine is bipolar 1. Lurasidone is bipolar 1 as monotherapy or adjunct to lithium and valproate. There's cariprazine coming in as a monotherapy in bipolar 1 disorder. So a couple of comments. You can see the check boxes, which I think make it very clear. We clearly need new agents in this space. There's no doubt about that. And I think it's also safe to say that many people don't prescribe lithium or valproate. In fact, lithium has been dropping off in North America as a prescription, which is kind of a shame because lithium still remains a gold standard mood stabilizer. It reduces suicide rates in bipolar disorder. It seems to be cardioprotective to the bipolar patient. That's not an academic point because the most common cause of death in bipolar disorder is cardiovascular disease. Third and final point, a friend of mine in Copenhagen in Denmark has some really interesting data showing that lithium decreases amyloid deposition in the brain. And what's really concerning, but yet opportunistic, when you look at people who have bipolar disorder, their hazard for Alzheimer's is much greater than the general population. And the more episodes they have, the hazard goes up and up and up. If you give them lithium, the hazard for Alzheimer's is no different than the general population. It's pretty interesting. And the age of onset of Alzheimer's is much earlier in bipolar, so the risk is higher the age of onset earlier. But lithium just doesn't do well with public relations. Patients go on Dr. Google, and they say, what the hell are you putting me on, right? Now, valproate's been around since 1882. Old drug, lithium, 1817. One of my students said, it's been around longer than that. It's been around since the Big Bang. I said, okay, your point's well taken. 1817 when it was discovered. And so lithium, 1817, valproate, 1882. These are fossils, using them for a long time. Valproate, I don't use much anymore. I use it sometimes in mania, not as much as I used to. Don't know where you live, but in Toronto, most pregnancies are not planned. And that's an issue for reproductive age women. The teratogenicity risk is much higher than we thought. We always think about anatomical teratogenicity, as we should, neural tubes. We shouldn't forget cognitive or behavioral teratogenicity. Some experts in the field would take a view that valproate should not be prescribed anymore in bipolar because of the risk with respect to not just teratogenicity, but also it's associated with polycystic ovarian syndrome, and there's many other types of side effects with it. I think it's a longer conversation whether we would just veto it entirely. I certainly still use it, but I have to say it's really dropped off in my practice. It doesn't really treat bipolar depression. It doesn't have long-term recurrence prevention data. I think we have better drugs now in our field.